Hey guys, this is Frank Yecker, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Hey, this is Rich Franklin.
What's up, everybody? This is Chris Lieben.
This is Diego Sanchez.
Randy Couture.
Alex Overeem.
Hi, this is Stephen Bonner.
This is Don Fry.
Hey, I'm Phil, Mr. Wonderful Davis.
TJ Dillashaw.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
Submission Radio.
You're listening to Submission Radio.
Welcome to Submission Radio. It's the 7th of March, a weekend of crazy upsets in the MMA world, and we're all over it on this UFC 196 Submission Radio Breakdown Special. Dennis Grout here with Casper Ozalowski, as always. And Cas, I feel like I'm saying this to you almost every week now, but how crazy were the fights over the weekend?
I know. Last weekend, it was Anderson Silva, Michael Bisping. Now, twice the action, twice the value, twice the craziness, twice the controversy. Well, it's a controversy. It's not controversy. Twice the big things to discuss. McGregor losing, Holly Holm losing, Misha Tate's the new champion, Nate Diaz is the king of Stockton, although I have a feeling that he was already the king of Stockton. There's a lot to discuss, and we've got some sexy guests to discuss all these happenings with us, don't we, Dennis?
Yeah, that's right. Joining us on the show, we're very lucky to have Mark Ramondi, who's the assistant editor from MMA Fighting. He'll be jumping on and giving us an analysis of what exactly was going on at the event, the atmosphere, how many Irish fans were there, and all that kind of good stuff. So we're very excited to speak to him. Also joining us on this breakdown, you guys may remember we did this last time. Tommy Toholder is going to come on the show and give us his top five moments from UFC 196. That's going to be very exciting to see what Tommy thinks stood out to him from the event. And finally, the man that you guys all requested to come on the show for a breakdown, Robin Black, will come onto Submission Radio and break down the two big fights with us. It's going to be all very, very exciting, and I cannot wait for these guys to come on the show, Cas.
Me either, man. I'm super excited. Robin Black, for those of you who don't know, is a guy that we get requested almost weekly, all the time. People ask, have you had Robin Black on the show? You should get Robin Black on the show. Well, we figured, why not do it when we do these breakdown specials? We're like UFC 196, obviously a massive event. We're going to do a breakdown special. Why not finally get Robin Black? So I'm very, very excited to get Robin Black on the show. Obviously, you know him from the Fight Network and all the amazing, amazing breakdowns he does. So I'm curious what he's got in store and what his opinions are. As always, don't forget to follow us on Twitter at SubmissionAUS. Tweet us, let us know what you think, give us your feedback. Like the page on Facebook, Submission Radio AUS. There's tons of different content than what we do on the Twitter. Subscribe. If you haven't already subscribed, do it. Do yourself a favor. There's a lot of great content coming up. Obviously, we're going to be going to UFC Brisbane in just a couple of weeks, so we'll have tons and tons and tons of content coming up. And if you haven't done it yet, feel free to give us a rating on iTunes, because it helps the show.
Yeah, and if you guys do pop on our YouTube page, check out the technique of the week. Right now, we've got we just had Anthony Perosh show some really basic but useful submissions and escapes in Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu, and we've got something exciting coming up for you guys as well, so keep an eye out for that. That comes out every Wednesday, the Submission Radio Technique of the Week. But Cas, without further ado, we've got our first guest on the line, and he's ready to give us a breakdown of UFC 196.
All right, guys, our next guest is the assistant editor at MMAfighting.com. You may also remember him from his great work at Fox Sports and the New York Post. It's a pleasure to welcome Mark Ramondi for the first time to Submission Radio. Mark, welcome. How's it going today?
Hey, guys, how's it going?
Yeah, it's going very well now that you're on the program. Now, it's been a crazy weekend. We appreciate your time. Before we jump into the actual event, you were in Vegas leading up to the fights. First of all, we saw some clips of Irish fans in Vegas, but how much of a turnout did you actually notice? And how would it compare to UFC 194 or UFC 189?
It was less Irish fans than there were at UFC 189. I think 189 was kind of the pinnacle, where it was just insane and there were so many Irish fans. There must have been just thousands and thousands of Irish fans in 189. And since July, I think it's slowly eroded a little bit, and it's understandable, because I mean, how many times can you ask these fans to pay all that money to come out and come to Vegas? And Vegas is not cheap, as I'm sure you guys know. So I can't blame the lads for not coming out, but there was still a great crowd. You know, it wasn't sold out, but the atmosphere was great in the arena. It certainly wasn't lacking for any kind of energy or anything like that. And I thought the Irish fans were actually very classy in defeat last night. They conducted themselves very well.
We saw, obviously, the very entertaining lead-up between Diaz and McGregor, and then the, you know, heartbreaking to many of them loss, obviously. Is there anything that the cameras didn't capture that you noticed from McGregor or Diaz that stood out in your mind, or perhaps even, you know, from the Irish fans, something that you noticed?
honestly, the buzz in the arena was very weird when Diaz sinked in the choke and Connor tapped. It was it wasn't silent, but it was just kind of like a weird buzz, like almost being stunned. And I don't know if I can compare it. Like, I was in the arena when Weidman beat Silva the first time, and that was like a stunned silence. Like no one was quite sure what just happened, and it was kind of like that. It was more comparable to that than like an uproarious like cheer from the crowd. It was more of like confusion and more of just like, you know, we just watched something incredible, but we're not really sure how to digest it yet, type of thing. It was very unique, so I thought that was a pretty interesting aspect of it.
Let me just jump in there for a second. Talk to us about the crowd and what it was like in there. Obviously, Nevada's a lot closer to Stockton than Ireland is. Would you say it was a very pro-Connor crowd, or were there still a lot of Diaz supporters in and amongst the crowd? What was the ratio like?
That was a pro-Connor crowd. There was no doubt about it. I'd say probably 75% for Connor. He got, the biggest cheers by far of the night. Actually, Diaz got booed a little bit when he came out. But there were certainly, you know, a vocal section of the crowd that was going for Diaz. But there was no doubt, you know, McGregor was the fan favorite last night.
Now, before we get into the fight, I mean, let's talk about the build-up to the fight. There were a lot of great moments from the two press conferences to the stare-downs. I want to get your favorite media moment that stood out to you leading into this event.
Favorite media moment. Favorite media moment actually wasn't one that we were all in the room for. It was that CNBC interview.
Yes.
You guys see that where McGregor and Diaz were, you know, they were head to head on the screen and they were being interviewed and being asked all these questions about money and finance, and you know, the interviewer clearly didn't know anything about the UFC or MMA, and Nate Diaz clearly didn't even know why he was there and why he was doing the interview. And it was just so random and so strange, and the answers were so priceless that it was just gold. That it just worked. Like somehow it could have been a complete train wreck, and it was, but in the best way possible. It was just so funny.
I think it's funny because I don't think they were meaning for it to be like this, but I think it's going to be one of those classic infamous moments in MMA where the hardcore fans will always remember that interview, and there'll be a lot of references. And I love Nate Diaz's responses to so many things Conor McGregor said to him, which was just, yeah, right. And you saw that throughout that whole interview. It was awesome. Now, before we obviously get up the card, two massive upsets on the event, and we want to grab your thoughts on both, but before we do, Eric Silva lost in brutal fashion to Nordin Taleb. Mm-hmm. What does this mean for Silva now that he's on the second loss in a row?
It's tough to say, man. You know, he's obviously in kind of a crossroads of his career. You have to give him a little bit of rope, though, because this was his first camp in California working at King's MMA. So, you know, he had to adjust to a new gym, to a new camp, to a new setting. You know, you can't say enough about Master Rafael Cordero. The things that he's done for the careers of Rafael Dos Anjos and Fabricio Werdum have been incredible. So I'm sure that Eric Silva feels that something similar can happen to him. And usually in the first fight at a new camp, you don't really get to see that completely and fully. So I'm going to wait until I see Silva again to say for sure whether or not he really has like a bright future in the UFC or not.
Let's jump to the first upset. Tate beats Holm. I mean, Renee could choke. Everyone goes crazy. Holm is on her way to cruise to a win, but Tate pulls it off. Give us your thoughts on the fight and what should be next for Tate.
Well, I thought it was a great fight. I thought it was the fight of the night for sure. I thought they got robbed, actually, because the fight of the night went to Diaz and McGregor. I thought that Tate and Holm had the fight of the night by far, and I thought one of the fights of the year, to be honest with you. I thought that fight was dramatic from the very start. It wasn't always the most exciting fight in terms of action, but it was always technical. It was always tactical. You know, both women always were at a very high level, and just the way that Tate won. How many times have we ever seen in MMA and in the UFC where a challenger is losing the fight in the fifth round and somehow pulls out a finish to win the fight with only a few minutes left? It's only happened, very few amount of times. And the only case that I can really think of that stands out to me is when Anderson Silva got Chael Sonnen in the triangle and their first fight. Silva was the champion already, though, so it wasn't the challenger, you know, winning the belt. But it was, you know, he was losing that entire fight up until that point. And Tate was losing that fight, and she came in, and she, you know, almost a desperation takedown. She dragged Holm down, got her back, put her in the choke. Holm tried to throw her off, and she held on for dear life, and she cinched it in, and Holly Holm didn't tap and just went unconscious. I mean, what an incredible moment, just an incredible sequence of events. Thought that was really awesome. I'm still excited about that fight, right, even right now.
And what an amazing way and an amazing job you just did of obviously repainting that picture. What do you think is next for Tate, though? She was very, I wouldn't say quiet at the press conference, but she didn't want to commit to anything. What do you think is next for her?
It's funny, you know, someone asked Misha that at the press conference, and then I was talking to Brian Caraway, obviously, you know, her boyfriend and her longtime coach after, and I asked him what was next, and, you know, he was almost offended that I was asking him what was next, because they want to enjoy this right now. You know, this is something that they've worked for, that Misha has worked for so many years to win the UFC title. You know, there was a time where Misha Tate didn't think she'd ever even be in the UFC because there was no women fighting in the UFC. And then, you know, she lost to Rousey twice. She got kind of, passed on for that title shot back in November. So there was just so much emotions about winning that fight. As for what I think they should do next, I mean, it's hard to say. I know they're not going to want to have Tate fight again until she fights Rousey. I know, yeah. I know for a fact the UFC, they feel like they screwed up already by having Holm fight Tate. They wanted the Rousey Holm rematch to be the next fight, so they already feel like they screwed up because they rolled the dice and they didn't come out with the winner they wanted. So I would severely doubt Tate fights again until Rousey comes back in November or whenever it happens. Could they do Tate versus Holm again? You know, run it back and do a rematch. I would not be upset about that. That was such a great fight. And then at least the winner could then go fight Rousey, and it would be a great storyline. But, you know, Tate's not fighting Amanda Nunes, you know, this summer. There's no way that's going to happen. I know that for sure. So it's either going to be Holm next or Rousey next, and most likely Rousey next.
Yeah, no more rematches, Mark. We've had enough of these rematches. We need to get things moving. I mean, that would be ridiculous.
I'm with you.
Another rematch. You mentioned Holm. Let's just quickly touch on it for 1 second. I mean, massive, massive win here in Melbourne. Me and Casper were there. It was an unbelievable experience seeing it happen. And now she loses in her first title defense with a lot of people watching, expecting her to win. Where does she go from here, and how much steam has she lost with this loss?
She loses a little bit of steam, sure, but Holly Holm is still a star. I don't think she loses that much because she was winning that fight. You know, she was winning that fight. And it was almost, you know, she won the third round, she won the fourth round, and she was almost cruising. And, you know, it was almost like, all right, Tate had her moment in the second round, and now Holm has kind of figured it out, and she's going to cruise to victory. And then Tate, you know, just pulled something out of her hat at the very last second. So the Holm-Rousey fight is still going to be there at some point if they do it correctly. And that's still a mega fight. It's still a massive, massive fight. Holly Holm is still going to be a star. There's going to be a fight again with Tate. It may not be right away, but there'll almost certainly be a fight again with Tate. And those three women right now, that triangle, that triumvirate of stars in the division is really gonna push that division, I think, to becoming a really big one and a really important one. And I tweeted last night, I compared it to when light heavyweight back in the day had Chuck Liddell, Tito Ortiz, and Randy Couture, where all those guys fought each other. They were all big, big money fights. You know, and they all matched up differently with each other. They all had different personalities. I see that coming next with that division. It's going to be a really, really exciting time.
Let's jump to Conor McGregor and specifically his entrance before we really get into the thick of it. It didn't seem like it was the same special moment it usually, you know, is. What was it like live to you, though? Was it different in the arena?
Well, the fight was absolutely incredible. The fight was...
Before we get to the fight, how was McGregor's entrance? Yeah. Because it just didn't seem as big as it usually is.
It still felt like a special moment in the arena. I still feel like there was a lot of buzz in the arena. I think maybe, like I said earlier, you know, there were not as many Irish fans who made the trip. So maybe that played a part into it a little bit. I also think, honestly, I think that there was a little bit of an emotional drain after the women's fight. I think that fight was so exciting. And I got to tell you guys, the fans were into that fight from the start. They were on their feet at the end of the second round when Tate was beating up Holm on the ground. They were on their feet. They were going crazy. You know, throughout the fight, there was back and forth chants, Misha, Misha, Holly, Holly. And then when Tate won, the place just it went bananas. And the main event only happened a few minutes after that. And I feel like the entrances may have been a little subdued because the fans were emotionally exhausted after that incredible back and forth title fight. So I think that may have been it. That may have been why it seemed that way.
Now, Mark, the fight saw Diaz take a beating in the first round. I'm just wanting to know, what was going through your mind in between the rounds when they were sitting on their stools? Did you think that Diaz was going to be finished in the second?
I definitely knew McGregor was winning the fight. That was pretty clear. I don't know if I thought for sure that Diaz was going to be finished. I knew that McGregor was obviously doing by far the most damage, and I figured that would continue into the second round. It was one of those fights that it was so crazy and so enjoyable that I kind of like almost put like my reporter hat down for a second. And I was just like enjoying it as a fan. Like I almost like stopped scoring the fight. I try to, you know, I try to score the fights as a judge would, but in that fight I was just like, oh man, this is crazy. You know, these guys are just swinging and really going for it. I knew that Nate was obviously getting tagged and he was getting beat up, but he never stopped coming, man. Like he never was really rocked. He was never wobbled, and every time McGregor hit him, he just kind of shook it off and came right back, and I think that got into McGregor's head a little bit.
Well, McGregor obviously got hit with those shots by Diaz in the second round, then he goes for a takedown, which then turned into Diaz submitting him for a win. At the press conference, he discussed, McGregor did, how he used up his energy, but what did you think happened to McGregor? Did Diaz rock him, or was it pure exhaustion that caused McGregor to lose?
I think it was a combination of a lot of things. I think there was certainly some exhaustion because McGregor kind of was a headhunter. It was a little bit of a different style than he's used in the past. He was trying to knock Nate Diaz out from the very beginning, and was certainly very tired. He was certainly exhausted because he kept throwing big knockout punches. They weren't working. You know, some of them were landing, some of them weren't. But the ones that were landing were not knocking Diaz out. They were not even dropping Diaz, and they were barely even rocking Diaz, and Diaz just kept coming forward. So that played a part into it. The physical aspect of McGregor throwing those punches was obviously depleting his energy. The other part of it too, I think, was the mental thing. McGregor has knocked every other guy out with that left hand in his entire career. Every other guy has been knocked out, folded up with that left hand. Jose Aldo, one of the best pound-for-pound fighters in the history of MMA, was knocked out in 13 seconds by that left hand. He hit Nate Diaz a lot of times with that left hand, and Nate Diaz did not go down. He stayed in there, and he his face was all busted up, but he just continued coming forward. And I think mentally, that may have been like, for McGregor, it might have been like, well, what the hell do I have to do to knock this guy out? And I think at the end of that, you know, in that middle portion of the second round when Diaz won, it was all of those things combining, and then Diaz hit him a couple times and hurt him, and McGregor shot him for a takedown. You know, the striker, the great striker, has to go for a desperation takedown because he's tired, he's rocked, he's mentally he doesn't know what to do. It was an incredible crazy turn of events. It was very interesting to watch. It was pretty crazy.
Mark, the big question now is, Diaz beats the biggest star in MMA. What happens to him next? Who would you like to see him fight next? What makes sense?
That's actually a good question. I think that from now on, Nate is a big money fighter. I think he may not be a guy who fits into one division, which I think is kind of what Nick has become as well, but he's a guy you can slot into big money fights, you know, at 170, at 155. I think that there's a few options for him right now. I've seen some people saying, you know, have him fight Robbie Lawler once, for the 170-pound title. I wouldn't hate that. You know, I would certainly watch that, and it would be a fun fight. Also, you know, why not throw him in against Dos Anjos again? The last time those two guys fought, obviously RDA, destroyed Diaz, but Diaz was not himself in that fight. The Diaz that fought RDA back in December 2014 was obviously not the guy who fought Conor McGregor last night in Vegas. That's pretty clear to me. You know, Diaz was hurt going into that fight. He really wasn't that motivated going into that fight. I wouldn't mind seeing that fight again. You, you could do that again. You could do Diaz against Eddie Alvarez. You can do Diaz against pretty much any guy who has a name in the 170-pound or 155 division. But more than anything, what I'd like to see from Nate next is whatever Nate wants to do. Give him the chance to say, this is what I want next. He just made a boatload of money. He's probably going to take some time off. And why not? He deserved it. He earned it. He just fought in December against Michael Johnson. So whatever Nate wants to do next, that's what Nate should do next, I think.
Well, there you go. Some great thoughts there from Mike Raimondi. And you guys can catch him on MMAfighting.com. A lot of fantastic articles. And make sure to follow him on Twitter at Mark_Raimondi. Mark, thank you so much for your time. And thanks for coming on to Submission Radio.
Thanks so much, guys. I really appreciate it.
And there he is, Mark Raimondi himself. We really appreciate his time and obviously excellent analysis. A first time on Submission Radio. I'm sure we'll have him back on many, many more times in the future. Now, we will be having Robin Black on the show to break down UFC 196, almost like a double breakdown. I think by the end of the show, it's going to be almost like a triple breakdown. Before we do, though, consider this almost like a halftime show if we were the Super Bowl, a much, 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 much smaller version of the Super Bowl. We have some fun entertainment for you guys, something that has pretty much become a tradition. A man very much loved in the MMA community for his hilarious brand of MMA-flavored humor. He's going to be giving you a bit of a dose today. Tommy, welcome back to Submission Radio. Whenever you're ready, take it away.
What's up, my Submission Radio friends? I am Tommy Toehold, the cartoon equivalent of shitting your pants at your wedding. And speaking of shit, holy fucking shit, UFC 196 was insane! Everything has changed after last night. The world is no longer round, trees are now underground, puppies and kittens have become horrifying beasts that strike terror in the hearts of men. I have no idea whether there's going to be a tomorrow. And why, you ask? Because Corey Anderson took Tom Lawler to a decision. Holy shit! It finally happened, you guys! There are no more barriers to cross! I'm just kidding, Conor McFucking Gregor lost a fight. Now, Conor has lost fights in the past, but that was before he became a god king with mystical powers and the ability to circumvent space-time. And who better to throw a steaming pile of shit onto a billion-dollar cut of steak than a fucking Diaz, brother? Nate Diaz has been waiting his entire life just for a moment like this, where he could throw a wrench into a giant machine and tear that shit to pieces. And that is exactly what Nate did last night. Kinda. I mean, the UFC's better numbers than they've ever had. Conor McGregor's still a megastar and the featherweight champion. And the UFC's closest rival headlined their biggest card of the year with two men who were alive for the American Revolution. So it didn't really throw a wrench into anything, but it fucking felt like it did. And for a few minutes, everybody thought, holy fucking shit, MMA will never be the same. Even though it is exactly the same as it was the day before. But the thing is, this is happening at least like once every two fucking months, and I love the shit out of it. Holly Holm beats Ronda Rousey, and it's the most shocking thing that has ever happened in the world. Misha Tate beats Holly Holm, and I somehow feel just as fucking shocked. Seriously, the last year felt like Matt Serra was beating GSP on almost every single fucking card. For a decade, there were like three guys, and nobody could beat them, and we just got used to that. Oh, this guy's the best. I guess he'll be the champion for a few presidential administrations. No, not anymore. Nobody is safe. Michael Bisping beat the greatest fucking fighter of all time. Suddenly there's parity in this sport, and that is what makes sports fucking awesome. I love a good run on an undefeated fighter, but is there anything better in the world than somebody coming out of nowhere and just fucking wrecking that shit? Which reminds me, fuck Rocky III. I would have been jacked at Clubber Lang 1. I mean, the whole Mick dying, that's pretty fucked up, but just like get rid of that stuff, and I would have been a Clubber Lang fan in that one. The thing that makes parody fun in sports is that you don't know what the fuck is gonna happen. More importantly though, we think we know what's gonna happen, and then something else happens. Fuck yeah. Fuck yeah, unpredictability. I hope I never get used to this shit. What a fucking time to be alive. UFC 196 was one of the best cards ever, minus the entire main card before the co-main and the main event. And I'm sure I'll be saying the same thing about the next one. Thank you for having me on, my friends. I'm Tommy Toehold. Go check me out at youtube.com/TommyToehold, where I say cuss words there too. Later, fight fans.
Hi, this is Gunnar Nelson, and you're listening to Submission Radio.
Joining us here for our UFC 196 breakdown is one of Fight Network's top analysts. He's making his debut on Submission Radio today. It's a pleasure to welcome Robin Black for the first time to Submission Radio. Robin, welcome to the program.
Hey, guys. Thanks for having me, man. Hang out and talk fights, especially after a night like that. Put me down for one of those.
Well, I mean, let's talk about the night because, Robin, we know you don't have too much time. In a landscape where we've seen so many close fights, it was a night of definitive action where we saw two fights possibly change the future and landscape of the UFC. We're, of course, talking about Misha Tate beating Holly Holm and Nate Diaz's win over Conor McGregor. We're going to kick it off by discussing Holm versus Tate first. I mean, it shocked the world when Tate pulled off the upset via rear naked choke in the final round. But before we discuss the fight, I just want to go around and ask you guys about your thoughts and expectations and predictions for this fight before it even happened. Did anybody actually predict Tate to win this one? Robin, I'll go with you first.
No. In fact, I predicted it to look exactly the way it looked, except for the way it ended. You know, I studied Holly Holm very closely. My very first job with the UFC, I do breakdowns for the UFC, and I was in Dana White's office when I first met them to interview about, you know, bringing my analytical breakdowns and doing other stuff. And he said, your first job, I want you to go and tell me how Holly Holm versus Ronda Rousey is going to go down. And I'm like, okay, this is my first big gig for the UFC. I can't mess around. And so I studied every second of Holly Holm that was on tape. And I actually came out with a breakdown that suggested that I thought she could beat Ronda Rousey if she struck from the boxing range and struck outwards and went out to the kicking range and made Ronda keep chasing her. And that's what she did. And I expected exactly the same thing against Misha, which is exactly what we saw, except for Misha got her down in the second. But by the fifth, you're like, well, she's up three rounds. She's been playing the game plan perfectly. This thing is over. But Misha stays in it till the end, man. And it's her heart that is so beautiful to see. I mean, she's a beautiful girl. Don't get me wrong. But it's her heart that is so beautiful to witness. And to see her hang out and hang in there right down to round five. And then once she accessed the back, just go for broke. It was wonderful. It's the kind of thing that moves you. If you don't feel emotional after witnessing somebody accomplish their dreams in that kind of way, you should check your pulse. You might be dead.
Yeah, we definitely weren't dead here. We were entertaining, had a whole bunch of people here all watching the fights with us. We were jumping up like little girls, going crazy over that finish. But, you know, obviously going into that fight, I thought that Holly Holm would be able to stuff Misha Tate's takedowns. She's obviously very big, very athletic, and thus far has displayed great takedown defense. And, yeah, much like you, Robin, I think most people, I thought that Holly would pick Misha apart from the outside. And I felt like, you know, Misha would learn from Ronda's mistakes and not rush in. And, you know, even though we hadn't seen too much from Holly's ground game, I did expect her to be able to fend off any submissions from Tate. And, you know, even though Misha has shown to be tremendously tough, like you mentioned, through many, many fights, I thought that eventually in a five-round fight, I thought Holly would be the one to catch her with something and potentially finish her, because we've seen Misha tough in three-round fights. I thought in a five-round fight, Holly might be able to put her away.
Yeah.
Sorry, go on, Robin.
Sorry, guys. Basically what you thought, I think most people thought, and it's exactly what they saw for round one, three, and four.
Yeah, it was one of those situations as well where I'd love to sort of meet someone who predicted the Tate win. And of course, there was that man in Vegas. I don't know if you guys saw this, who won $220,000. And he's sitting pretty over there, I think. He is maybe one of the only people that really backed Tate. And very interesting to see that happen. But now Tate is UFC champion. It was an upset, but also it seemed like a lot of massive, well, the massive rematch between Holm and Rousey is definitely off the cards now. I just want to ask you, Robin, do you think Tate winning the title is good for business? And if you are UFC, would you book Rousey versus Holm or Rousey versus Tate in November?
Well, the one thing that we started to notice lately is, and I think rightly so, whatever jobs we all do, you know, our bosses kind of tell us what to do and structure our jobs. But if you can make yourself really valuable, you get to have input into that. And sometimes you can even kind of write your own way. And Conor McGregor did that. People would say, why is he getting to keep this belt? Why is this thing happening? Why is he fighting for a second belt? Why doesn't he have to fight? When Conor McGregor can bring in $100 million just by fighting, Conor McGregor gets to say how it's going to go. And I think Ronda's one of those people. I think the fight that happens is dependent entirely on Ronda Rousey. If Ronda says, fuck belts, I want to avenge that loss, that's the fight that happens. If Ronda says, I don't care about that, I want to win the UFC championship and retire, I can smash Misha. She calls Dana White and Lorenzo and says, that's what I want. That's what happens. Ronda Rousey is worth so much business that whatever she wants is what will happen.
That's very good points, Robin. Honestly, if I'm the UFC, I'm making Rousey Tate as quickly as possible because, in my opinion, and I think most people's opinion, Rousey is the real draw, and Misha isn't going to promote her fights like Ronda did. I mean, obviously, we saw her doing a bunch of interviews before this, but, you know, it didn't garner the interest that a Ronda Rousey fight would. And I also get the feeling that Misha Tate is taking a bit of a stand against the UFC after they, you know, reneged on her initial title shot. There was a moment in the press conference, post-fight press conference, Robin. I'm not sure whether you saw this or whether you sort of picked up on it, but she was basically asked about what's next, and she seemed to put a foot down about how she's going to talk to her management, decide what made sense next, and then they would talk to the UFC in that order. And it kind of seemed like she was trying to say something, maybe a bit of a, you know, power struggle, and it was a stark contrast to letting the UFC pick whoever's next. And obviously there's some intrigue too, because it's the other way now. You know, you've got Misha, who's the champion, and Ronda coming back. It's like a throwback to when Ronda Rousey initially won the belt in Strikeforce. And, you know, coupled with the fact that no one really knows where Ronda is mentally, I think, it, you know, it makes the fight interesting. And the other thing is, if you give Ronda Holly, there's a chance Holly beats Ronda again, and then her chances at the belt are pretty much gone. And also, if Ronda beats Misha, then you have the Holly rematch anyway. So, you know, I would probably go the Misha Tate versus Ronda Rousey route and try and get that belt back on Rousey as soon as possible.
Mm. And the thing I wanted to ask you, Robin, is, and Dave Meltzer brought up this point in the post-fight show through MMA Fighting, is that after watching that performance from Holly Holm, you start wondering if Ronda Rousey does come back and she does change up her game plan, does get it to the ground somehow, does she have more of a chance of beating her than we sort of originally thought after watching that fight in Melbourne where she got absolutely destroyed? Do you think that this performance from home sort of makes it look a little bit more human and gives fans the thought that Rousey does have more of a shot against her if this rematch happens and she has the right strategy?
You know, it's a technical thing. The issue is that Misha shoots sort of double leg. She shoots traditional wrestling takedowns, and that gets you in on the hips. Ronda kind of needs the clinch, and the key is not just how you attack the wrestling or the clinch, it's how you move your feet. And Ronda's weakness against Holly Holm was her footwork. Holm could just move around her and she didn't have the answers. She has a boxing coach who doesn't seem capable of giving the answers to handle it. So that's a hard one to overcome. But as far as, you know, Ronda fighting Holm, Ronda fighting Holly, Ronda fighting for the title, all of these things, we have to picture Ronda Rousey not as a sports team or as, you know, a creature. We have to picture her as a human being and put ourselves in her state. So you're Ronda Rousey for a moment, and somebody basically took their shin like a baseball bat and smashed you on the side of the face. When that happened, the whole world, every troll came out from under a bridge and made fun of you, openly mocked you and made you, you know, she talked about feeling suicidal. The worst of humanity happened. You witnessed all of it. And now you can go and act and hang out with your family and do all these other things and still study martial arts for love and just say, I don't want any part of that cesspool of humanity that's associated with the people who made fun of me and tried to, you know, verbally hurt me. I can walk away from it and go and make movies and make millions of dollars in other ways. Or I can go back and deal with it. If she's going to do that at all, in my opinion, it's going to be one time either to beat Holm or to beat Misha for the title, and then she's going to walk away and never come back. That's my opinion, and it's only my opinion based on myself imagining going through what she went through as a human, you know?
So you're basically saying because of all the negativity that she went through because of this Holm loss, she'll come back, sort of avenge whatever she needs to avenge, and then she'll leave because of the possibility of going through that experience again?
I mean, I just think just the negativity of having gone through it one time. I mean, you imagine, and it's not just her, imagine being, whether you're the singer from that Chad Kroeger guy, what's that band? They're Canadian, Nickelback, or whether you're Justin Bieber or whatever. You're a human being going through the grossest aspects of humanity. And the difference of being a fighter is somebody took their shin bone and smashed it against your jaw until you were unconscious. That's not you don't just wake up and say, yeah, I enjoy fighting and 3 million's enough. You do it because you need to, or you do it because you love it. But she has other things now. She has other aspects of her life. She goes to a red carpet and people do her makeup and tell her she looks beautiful and ask her which fragrance she'd prefer. I mean, do you really want to go back into a world where all you do when you open up anything in the world is have hundreds of thousands of people saying horrible negative things? I mean, just imagine that as a human being. If I'm her, I don't want to come back to that.
Mm, very thoughtful analysis there, Robin. And you know what? For once in our life, Submission Ray would like people to tell us we're pretty and ask us what fragrance we use, because that would be a highlight as well. But Casper, jumping on the other side of the coin, Holly Holm. I mean, we've been talking about Holm versus Rousey, but realistically, what does this loss mean for Holm? How much steam has her career lost after this?
I would say a lot. I mean, going to this fight, she was talking about not wanting to be remembered as a one-hit wonder and just for that win over Ronda. And, you know, when somebody's accomplished in boxing and kickboxing as Holly is, it'd be a crime to call him a one-hit wonder. But as far as MMA fans are concerned, it does affect her legacy greatly. I mean, you know, she was already being touted the next queen at bantamweight. And, of course, we remember the massive parade she received in her hometown of Albuquerque. And between the many media appearances and, obviously, the newfound sudden push for the UFC, she was really being groomed to take over where Ronda Rousey had left off. The UFC wanted her to be the new Rousey, just a different version. But unfortunately, she lost the belt in her first title defense in a fight that many people expected her to win. So, you know, people may be skeptical about calling her such a strong favorite in the future. And then you look at her early fights in the UFC, she was largely flying under the radar before she beat Ronda. So there was always this underlying feeling that one day she'd fight Ronda, but when she did, people thought it was a little bit too early. And only once she did beat Ronda Rousey, you know, did people feel like they'd seen the true potential of Holly Holm. And this fight, it very much reminded me of her previous fights in the UFC where, you know, people find them slightly underwhelming. And anytime you go from being like so heavily dominant to anything less, people are going to question you. Mm. In a previous fight, she seemingly had the perfect game plan and fought the perfect fight. And in this one, she made a costly mistake and it basically, you know, shattered the newfound aura of invincibility. And much like Conor McGregor, who we'll talk about obviously momentarily, she's now mortal. And without that belt, she's not going to be getting nearly the same push from the UFC, which obviously does hurt her career. So if Rousey does beat Misha and Holly gets a rematch, it'd be great for Holly's career.
Mm. You know, think about this idea. What if that one takedown was defended? So that one takedown at minute 23 is defended.
Mm.
And now we're having this conversation on Sunday. I'm having a beer, by the way. So I'm enjoying hanging out with you crazy Aussies.
Mm.
You're having this conversation over a beer on a Sunday with your crazy Aussie friends. And instead of saying it was shattered, we're saying that woman for 25 minutes completely controlled one of the top three woman fighters in the world. Do you know what I mean? That one thing, a butterfly flaps its wings in Texas and a tornado happens in the north. Like, if that takedown doesn't take place, this conversation is 100% different.
Mm.
If that's the case, should we really be talking about, you know, myths being destroyed and fighters, you know, the fact that you can see through people now and stuff? Do you know what I mean? It's like, it's such a small thing. And it's the same thing. If one of Conor McGregor's punches land differently, or if Nate Diaz's jaw was moved a different direction, or any of these things, variables happen, every conversation we're having today is different. Fighting is so close. It's a razor wire like that. And we should really, really work hard to avoid making these giant assumptions based on one takedown that led to a choke in minute 23.
Yeah, it's a very interesting point. And just finally on the fight, Robin, I just want to quickly get your thought. If Tate didn't get that submission, what would your analysis, or how would you rate Holly Holm's performance in this fight? Because like you mentioned, she was dominant in certain rounds, but did you rate her performance highly, or were you a little bit disappointed by what she did in there?
I was blown away, to be honest. I mean, you're looking at one of the best fighters in the world, and for 20, you know, of the 22 minutes or 23 minutes or 21 and a half minutes, whatever it was that we saw there, there was 3 minutes where Misha got her down and got to her back and showed that area that she'd been focusing on for a decade of her life and really was good. And Holly showed that unwillingness to get choked. And she showed it at the end too, until her body just started, you know, freaking out when she, as she passed out. And outside of that moment, she took former Strikeforce champion and one of the three best women fighters in the world, probably in human history, and she shut her out, beat her up, kept her at distance. Her first two fights in the UFC were kind of like that, but that is a top 30 and a top 40 female fighter. This was one of the top three in the world. I thought it was brilliant. But Miesha Tate showed the one thing that we all seem to really know about her, and that is that her heart is powerful, that her fearlessness is powerful, that her drive to win, her insatiable desire to get victory, that's what she has, and that's what won the fight for her, and that's very, very special.
Mm. Well, speaking about special moments in the night, I mean, how could we not talk about this? The main event, Conor McGregor versus Nate Diaz. It saw a massive come-from-behind victory for Nate Diaz, who not only had a short amount of time to prepare but to get into this fight, but, you know, it wasn't really picked by anybody to win this fight. Now, before we break this whole thing down, I'm going to ask a similar question like I did with the Tate-Holm fight. Robin, did you predict Nate to win this one? And if not, how did you think McGregor would beat him?
No, absolutely not. There was, I have been studying Conor McGregor since before he was in the UFC. And, you know, I have this really wonderful job that I get to study fighters. I get to do that for a living, and it's beautiful. And I appreciate it. I'm so grateful that I get to do that. And there's a few of them that are very, very special and that you spend extra attention on studying the way they move and the way they think and their personal philosophies, and because these are exceptional human beings. You know, Dominic Cruz is one that I've really looked at over the last few years, Carlos Condit for a long time, and Conor McGregor I put into that category. And I don't know about you guys in Australia, but over here in North America, somehow in the last half decade, our culture has become this very binary culture. Here, one of the things they call it is the Tinderization of North America. You know Tinder?
Yeah, we've heard of it.
Girlfriends, but we've heard about
and
it.
And by heard of it, you mean swipe right. Yeah. And picked up, what do you guys call, what's the Crocodile Dundee? Sheilas. You guys have picked up plenty of Sheilas by swiping
Sheilas
right.
Sheilas and birds, yeah.
We'd love to tell you we have, but we've got long-term girlfriends. But we'll say we have, yeah. Tons of Sheilas, yeah. Like 1,000 Sheilas for us.
Like thousands of Sheilas.
Yeah.
Well, Tinder is binary. I would like to have sex with this woman, swipe right. I would not like to have sex with this woman, swipe left. Mm-hmm. And that mentality is something Tinder is an obvious and comedic example, but it exists in many things technological related and has taught us to be very, very binary in our choices. Mm-hmm. So we look at things like either Conor McGregor is the greatest of all time, or he's absolute shite, and it's bollocks, and it was all nonsensical UFC hype. There's nothing in between. And I'm here to tell you that's just not the case. This is a very, very special fighter. Also, if we're going to put ourselves in Nate Diaz's shoes, think of it. Just really close your eyes for a moment and imagine you're Nate Diaz right now. You are so high. You are like smoking out of the best bongs money can buy with the guys you grew up with girls you like, sitting around with your arms in the air yelling Stockton 209 right now. Because not because you beat some bum, you beat a very special fighter. If we look at it and go, well, Conor McGregor, oh man, it was all hype, it was nonsense. You are diminishing the great, wonderful accomplishment that Nate Diaz made last night. And that is overcoming a very special fighter. Nate Diaz marched his ass into that cage, fearlessly stared this man down, took his best shots, stood up to him, and put him away. That is a magical, beautiful, wonderful thing that he did in front of all of us. And to be Nate Diaz today, 13 days ago, life was frustrating. Today, you just deposited a check for somewhere between $1.5 and $3 million. You got a signature win over a guy who pushed you to a nice limit that taught you about who, how special you are as a human being. And you are high on the finest weed that money can buy, smoking it out of the best bongs in the world in Stockton, California with all your friends. That is a magical thing. And, you know, so could you have predicted this? You could have. Did I? Absolutely not. Because Nate Diaz didn't just go in there and it turned out that, like I said, our binary culture was wrong and Conor McGregor's actually a bum. No, Conor McGregor's very special. And Nate Diaz was even more special on the night and accomplished something magical in a fight that was incredible. And we're all better human beings for having seen it.
Mm. Everybody's special. I feel very special right now, Robin. Thanks for that analysis. Very, very interesting. Let's jump into the fight, though, and start breaking things down a little bit. Casper, in the second round, we saw Nate start landing more and more shots, and McGregor looked more and more tired. Now, in the post-fight press conference, McGregor admitted that he began panicking a little bit when Diaz took his shots and went into autopilot, and he sort of started, like I mentioned, panicking a little bit. He said the wheel kick sort of took a lot of energy out of him and didn't really do what he wanted with Diaz. I'm just wondering, Casper, was it his weight? Was it the mental factor taking with Nate taking everything that McGregor had and keep coming forward? What's your theory on what zapped McGregor of all his energy and caused him to gas out? Or was it Diaz landing and rocking McGregor, which caused McGregor to go for that takedown?
Well, I think he expected to knock Nate out early with his big power shots. And to his credit, most people did. But, you know, instead, Nate ate Conor's big left a number of times, as well as big uppercuts and other big shots in general. But, you know, it wasn't enough to put Nate away. And there was also a lot of power shots thrown by Conor that never connected and missed their mark, which would have drained a lot of his energy. And that definitely didn't help. As far as the weight, I mean, on one hand, Conor was going up in weight, and that's... No, it's not always a Anthony Rumble Johnson scenario. The power doesn't always translate. Then you've got the fact that Nate has an incredible chin, and I think Conor may have been surprised that he wasn't able to put him away with that signature left. And once he realized that his biggest shots didn't put away, I think he was too late and he'd already expended too much energy. I mean, it's possible that maybe he wasn't used to fighting with all that weight on. When you do put on size, it takes time to adjust and get used to carrying that extra mass. And maybe it was a stark contrast to when he'd fight at 145 and fight lighter and be lighter on the night. But having said that, and Robin, I also want to get your thought, I don't really think that extreme weight cutting helps as far as improving cardio. So I would put it down to exactly what Conor said. He invested all of his energy into finishing Nate early. And when that didn't happen, he likely... I'm going to assume, obviously, Robin, I want your opinion as well, that he had an adrenaline dump from panicking, and those are the reasons why I think he gassed, because there was a moment, you could see it, when it seemed to tick over in Conor's mind that Nate was finding his rhythm and tagging Conor with big shots, and I think that's also something that, you know, drained Conor, when Conor sort of seemingly bounced back, tagged Nate with some very hard uppercuts, and Nate just ate them, and that's when you see Conor realize that he wasn't going to put this guy away, and he unfortunately didn't have enough energy to keep it up. You know, he shot him for that takedown, and then obviously got tapped out.
Would you play a game with me right now?
We love games, Robin.
Okay, I'd like to play a game of whose fault is that? And I want you to, one by one, give me each one of those sort of things that caused the scenario. So just pick any of them. Each of the ingredients that you've described, give me one of them.
Let's go with Conor McGregor panicking.
Whose fault is that?
I'm going to have to say, probably Nate Diaz for staying in there and going into autopilot, and then maybe McGregor for not mentally preparing himself for that outcome. Would that be right?
Well, no. It's not wrong. So here's how I'm going to look at it.
Okay.
Whose fault is that, and who gets the credit? So give me that one more time, and then we'll run that pass.
Okay, so Conor McGregor panicking. It was because Nate Diaz went into autopilot, and I possibly think maybe McGregor not mentally preparing for that outcome in this fight.
Yeah. So we're going to go with – and I'll answer it. Mm-hmm. Whose fault is that, and who deserves the credit?
Mm-hmm.
Whose fault is that? Conor McGregor's fault. And who deserves the credit? Nate Diaz.
Mm-hmm.
Conor McGregor going into autopilot is something that he, as a very trained martial artist who has dedicated himself to studying mentality and mindset, has to be prepared. Fighting is at its root about not allowing – those instincts to take over. So that is his failing. Who deserves the credit is Nate Diaz, because through his chin, his heart. So you're right. You gave both. His chin, his heart, his ability to stay in it, and all of the, and his fearlessness, he caused some mental duress in Conor McGregor, and therefore he deserves the credit. So name another one of these issues that were at play.
Let's say Conor McGregor getting choked out.
Okay, whose fault is that, and who deserves the credit? Conor McGregor's fault. There were many steps along the way that he could have stopped that. He could have not shot in for the takedown, bad choice. He could have, when he shot in for the takedown and was stuffed, made some other choices, sit outs. There's a million options you can make there. He could have, when the neck was wrapped up, made a different decision. He could have not burnt out his energy earlier, many things. Who deserves the credit? Nate Diaz. Nate Diaz choked that motherfucker out.
You know, Robin, I'm really enjoying this game, and I have an interesting one here for you, and I'm interested to see how you break this one down. Taking the fight at 170 on short notice, Nate Diaz taking the fight on short notice, Conor McGregor taking the fight at 170.
Okay, who's at fault and who deserves the credit? Mm-hmm. At fault is Conor McGregor, because his self-confidence, his overbelief in himself, his unwillingness and inability to look at the variables, the outcomes, properly recognize what some of the risks of 170 were. He was the guy in control. He could have said, no, make him fight at 155. Oh, he won't? Well, that's too risky. I'll fight somebody else. He had full control as the guy in control of the card, so it's on him. Who deserves the credit? Nate Diaz. No, motherfucker, I'm going to fight at 170.
Yeah, right. Hey,
I said I fought 155. These guys were like Nate Diaz. Basically, my point ultimately is whatever we search for, we want explanations. I want them. I'm a Conor McGregor fan. I'm somebody who has drawn inspiration from watching this guy grow. And the reason that I'm looking at it as it's all his fault is because he's going to look at it as it's all his fault. If a man with a true growth mentality, the only, you know, their gym, you may have heard this, one of their very common things that they say is we're either winning or we're learning.
Mm-hmm.
But we didn't win. So if we're learning, how are we going to learn? The way we're going to learn is find where we were flawed, where we made the errors, where we are responsible, and fix those things. And that's what he's going to do. Mm. And even at the post-fight press conference, you know, he wasn't looking for excuses. And other great fighters I admire, like Chris Weidman, admire him greatly. After he lost to Luke Rockhold, he made no excuses on the first night, but then it was a broken foot. And then it was a bad choice. And then he didn't feel like himself. I still admire him like crazy. I still think he can beat Luke Rockhold. But that's not the correct mentality. The correct mentality is, where did I fail and how can I grow as a result of understanding that? And that's what he's going to do. We all look for reasons, especially the fans, especially the Conor McGregor supporters, but I don't think Conor McGregor will look for reasons. He will look for his failings and he'll repair them.
Mm, wow, what an analysis. This is a great game, Robin, but let's jump into, I guess, what happens now. Now, Casper, a big, big loss. A lot of people around the world watching. I mean, a big alert for McGregor is the fact that a lot of people believed that he could do it all. He could jump around to any weight class. He sort of became superhuman in a lot of people's eyes. And this loss did make him seem human to a lot of people. You and me, Cass, we were watching a group of people. And there was, after the fight, there was a lot of energy sort of zapped from the room. A lot of big McGregor fans sort of, and us as well, because we're big McGregor fans as well. People sort of realized, hey, you know, a big part of this, I suppose, of this build, of his buildup is in a way gone for a bit. I just want to know, how much steam does this take away from McGregor, this loss? And also, can he still become the Floyd Mayweather of MMA? Does he still have the same drawing power as he did before?
Well, I mean, you ask, can he sort of still be the big drawing power, and how much steam does it take away? One of the biggest, I guess, issues with it now is that a lot of the super fights that were
connected to Conor McGregor, they go out the window. So the plans for UFC 200 potentially may have been Conor McGregor versus Robbie Lawler. That fight's now out the window. Then you've got Rafael Dos Anjos, that title fight, in my opinion, doesn't make sense anymore because Rafael beat Nate Diaz, and Nate Diaz beat Conor McGregor. I mean, you could market it, but I don't think that fight makes sense. So those are two super fights that are now off the table, and now it's almost like he has to go back to featherweight for now. He can come back to lightweight in the future, or go to lightweight in the future, but for now, I think he goes back to featherweight. So I think going to this fight, he was a man of three divisions. A lot of people were talking about lightweight, welterweight, and featherweight, and now he's back to the default of one, which really, I mean, the fact that he was, you know, wanting to go to welterweight and lightweight and featherweight at the same time was pretty amazing in on itself. So you can't really take too much away from him. But anyway, he's still the king at featherweight, and I guess he's got to face Aldo or Edgar next. So from a monetary standpoint, I guess he will be affected to a degree. I think his rise and ascension as a star, you know, it may have slowed a little bit, but in my opinion, it's a bump in the road. I think he'll go back to 145, and he may need to reinvent himself. And that's one of the things that I'm very curious about, because I don't think he can really continue with, you know, calling people gazelles and scared and things like that, because in a lot of ways, you know, Nate Diaz called his bluff and in a sense proved him wrong. So I'm curious to see how he goes to 145 and, being a master of selling a fight, how he's going to reinvent himself and sell those fights and get people excited.
And Robin, before you jump in, I just want to ask, you know, a lot of people comparing this to Chael Sonnen, for example. Chael Sonnen lost a bunch of times in his career, was still a major draw. Chuck Liddell, for example, Chuck Liddell lost a bunch of fights. People still wanted him to fight, but McGregor did sell a lot of his fights on this idea that he was this invincible, sort of unstoppable human being. How much do you think this affects his drawing power, the fact that can he still become the Floyd Mayweather in a lot of way, the co-promoter with the UFC? How much does this affect him?
Well, it's a setback, that's for sure. Mm-hmm. I got to think that, you know, he's smart enough and he's compelling enough that it isn't the story, it's the man telling the story. So whatever story he tells next, I think he has the ability to get us drawn into it. So that next story may be about rebuilding. That next story may be about who knows. Chael is a friend. I like Chael very much. He's been a bit of a mentor to me at times, and he's a very, very brilliant man. But Chael was more performer than anything. He's on The Apprentice right now in North America. He is a big, brilliant performer. Conor McGregor is living his life in front of people. And I think he'll continue to do that. I think he will tell the story of rebuilding. I think he will give people insight into what it feels like to overcome these things. And mm-hmm. I think he'll just live it out. Whereas Chael acted it out, and Chael is brilliant. But I actually have a question about Rafael Dos Anjos to pass you guys, as you were mm-hmm. talking about Conor. The Conor RDA fight is off the table. Does a Nate Diaz, if you are the people who put on these shows, you are the promotional team at the UFC, can you go and take Nate Diaz, surprise motherfuckers, and all that kind of stuff, and him beating Conor and everything, and show him losing to RDA and build him up saying, you know, and make that rematch? Can you make the rematch at UFC 200, Nate Diaz versus RDA for the 155-pound title? And if you do, can you make it work? Can you make that a fight that people get really pumped about?
I don't know, because I think I really do feel like a lot of people feel like that fight was very, very recent and it was very dominant towards RDA. I almost feel like sort of Diaz, coming off this big win, you'd always want to do something else with him and capitalize on the fact that he's so popular now. Maybe give him a fight that might be more likely for him to come out victorious. And also, I'm really excited to see what happens between Khabib and Tony Ferguson. And I really think that maybe one of those guys should get a potential title shot. So I don't know. I don't know if the UFC could sell me, even if Joe Rogan sat there and spoke about the fight. And Joe Rogan usually just makes me believe anything that he says. He's just fantastic what he does.
Joe's genius. Joe's
even Robin, if you and Joe sat in a room together and you sold me on this fight, I'm not sure if it would get me as excited about it as the UFC would have liked me to.
Yeah, I don't think either Joe or myself are the people to do it. I think the right videos of Nate Diaz are the people. I think Nate Diaz is the guy to do it. Like, the guy just marched his ass out there in front of all those people and beat up a guy that people were freaked out by, that, like, that quite honestly was innovating. And Nate Diaz is like, innovating, fucking schminnovating. You know, like, I'm going to go out there. I'll fight him until I push him back, and I'll fucking put punches on him and I'll put him away. And that's exactly what he did. And, you know, there are, you can study fighting all you want. You can, there's a clip on Canadian television. Do you guys have hockey down there?
We have grass hockey, so we don't have ice hockey. We have the grass version.
Jesus Christ.
It's too warm.
Jesus Christ, there's a grass hockey now?
Yeah, yeah. We won the Olympics. It's no big deal, Robin, but we're sort of a big deal in the grass hockey world.
Yeah, right. Well, there is this clip here of this hockey coach, and he's sitting with his gut hanging out on TV here in Toronto, and he says, all the analytics in the world won't tell you about a fighter who will – or fighter, a hockey player who will block a shot with his face. And you laugh when you see it, but it's true. All the analytics in the world can't tell you which guy on the team is willing to slide down and take a puck to the face. That's what we call intangibles. And Nate Diaz, you can look at all the stats you want on Nate Diaz, but what the important stats are the stats that they don't even have stats for.
Mm.
You know, those intangibles. Mm. And he also has that weird kind of star power, maybe more in America than in Australia, where you just get him being honest. Honesty is a very compelling thing where we live over here because it's so rare. You put TV on and you see all these people saying TV things for a TV camera that they think a TV audience wants to hear. So when you do see somebody who's visceral and honest, it's compelling television. But when I think about being Nate Diaz today, it's, and Nick for that matter, it's like, who knows what's going through those guys' heads? They're like rewriting weird jazz odysseys on nunchucks right now. They're so high.
Yeah, no, for sure. I mean, and like you mentioned, the most premium of premium bongs. I'm super jealous of them. As far as the RDA matchup, just to get my two cents in there, I agree with you, Dennis. I do think that him, Nate Diaz losing to RDA is still pretty fresh in everybody's minds. I mean, he's on a good streak. He did beat Michael Johnson, but, you know, the guy that he beat now, all right, biggest star in the sport, and obviously was the heavy favorite. You could also make the argument that he is a featherweight fighter as opposed to what we previously thought. Here's a crazy idea, and I want to get your opinion on it, Robin. I was thinking about what makes sense. For me, it's not RDA. What about Robbie Lawler? You have to do something big with Nate Diaz now that he's got all this momentum. You can't just give him, you know, a big fight. I feel like most of the big fights in both welterweight are booked. Like, you've already got a seemingly number one contenders fight between Rory McDonald and Steve Wonderboy Thompson. Then you got Khabib and Tony Ferguson at lightweight. I feel like those are already set, but those are a few months away, and they're not going to be able to fight at UFC 200, either of those guys. So what about Nate Diaz versus Robbie Lawler? And there's that story about Nick Diaz beating Robbie Lawler back in the day. You've got something big for you, and I think, honestly, that would be a bigger fight at UFC 200 than RDA versus Nate Diaz. I think people may roll their eyes at a rematch, but maybe a huge fight between Robbie Lawler and Nate Diaz. What do you think about that, Robin?
Yeah, I think it's fun. I mean, yeah, the fact that Nick knocked him out, you know, is fun. You can enjoy that. But I think it's hard if Carlos Condit, it depends, you know. In a lot of cases, I tend to lean towards what's the great fight. And part of me, a very big, honest part of me, understands that my view of fighting is in the minority. That I'm like, Condit versus Lawler 2, my God, we got to see it. You know, we have to see it. That was an unbelievable 25 minutes. What if we had 25 minutes or less more? But I also know that the world doesn't necessarily work that way. You need to sell people on things. You need to give them a story they can wrap their head around. And is Nate Diaz a better story? I mean, we'd rather see Nick fight him. But I guess if you're looking down the road and you're thinking in terms of this, and I'm not 100% sure. In fact, I'm less than 50% sure that when conversations are being had in the UFC, that anybody's thinking anything of, if this fight is won by this person, that will lead to that.
Mm.
You know what I mean? Because they've understood after putting on, you know, 280 fight cards, 2,800 fighters, or 2,800 fights, which will be, you know, going on 6,000 fighters, that you can't predict it anyways. So there's no point kind of, you know, looking ahead like that. But if you could, sure, fight Nate. If Nate wins, he's the welterweight champion of the world. That's pretty exciting. Nice. If he loses, well, his big brother can come back and spank the shit out of the guy who beat his little brother. And besides, he knocked him out before. Mm-hmm. But I just don't feel like you can, in a world of so many variables, that you can bank on any of these things going the way you think they're going to go.
Mm. Now, Robin, we know you're very short on time. So final question, we're going to let you go. GSP was there at UFC 196, very coy. Didn't rule out the fact that he's not going to return, but didn't really confirm anything that he will return. If you're the booker, if you're Joe Silver and you've got GSP at UFC 200, who do you put him up against?
I mean, unfortunately for Conor McGregor and everybody that makes money from the Conor McGregor business, if he would have won that fight, that's the money fight. And if you're George, you're like, this guy can't handle my power double leg. This guy can't handle my elbows. This guy can't handle my athleticism. Conor would take it because it would be the most money ever made in fighting. And George would take it because he'd be damn sure he could beat that kid. And the UFC would make it because they're like, you know, they'd just be babbling incoherently at the idea of that much money. But again, you don't get to control those things. Nate Diaz stood up and said, I want some money. I want some glory, and did what he came to do. So you don't get to control those things. That's the fight. Outside of that, I don't know that George wants to do it. George loves the martial arts. But he also loves, you know, pretty girls and the odd nightclub and vodka soda and stuff. You know, it's like he lived a life of complete sacrifice during that period. And he's one of the few guys who's made seven figures as a result of it. So he's only going to fight if he can't live without fighting. And I don't know that that's the case, but we'll see.
And you can almost argue a guy that went out on top and although did take a lot of damage in a number of fights, at least got out before he was getting knocked out cold all over the place. So, Robin, thank you so much for your time. Guys, you can watch Robin on the Fight Network and make sure to follow him on Twitter at RobinBlackMMA for his great MMA analysis. Definitely one of the most unique MMA analysis guys in the game, and so lucky to have you on Submission Radio. Robin, thank you so much for coming on the program.
It was my privilege, guys. I'd love to do it again. I'll chill three beers next time.
Awesome. Well, we look forward to having some Skype beers with Robin Black, obviously, next time we have him on. And there he is, guys, the man, the myth, the legend, Robin Black. I'm sure he'll be back on Submission Radio soon. And hopefully you're enjoying this breakdown so far. We're going to leave you with just a few more of our final thoughts before we sort of pull the plug on this episode. And just one thing that I want to say, obviously, about the Miesha Tate-Holly Holm fight, I just want to explore that one a little bit further. I mean, we've always known that Miesha was extremely tough, having her orbital bone broken in the first round by Sarah McMahon and coming back to win that fight. You know, that was certainly proof. But against Holly, she really showed that she has the will and the spirit of a champion. She was losing that fight. In it, she showed resolve and she fought to the very end. And there's a lot of people who I think would have accepted defeat and broken mentally because the fight wasn't going their way. Miesha didn't. And we all love Robbie Lawler. We spoke about him just before because, you know, he comes alive at the end of fights and fights hard to the end. And I think Miesha Tate is similar in that aspect. She's got the champion's mentality, and it honestly reminded me of, you know, we've already said this, but Anderson Silva submitting Chael Sonnen the first time they fought. It was absolutely insane. And I think that Ronda losing and taking time off, not just losing, but the fact that she did take that time off, it was the best thing that could have happened for Miesha Tate's career. And I think she's gone from sort of floating around in limbo and trying to find herself in the division while avoiding the label of gatekeeper to really finding vindication and cementing a solid legacy.
Yeah, no, certainly. But what I'm curious about is, obviously, she's very mentally strong in these situations where there's not much trash being talked and also not much emotion in the build-up. Her and Holly Holm were almost friend-like going into this fight, but in that Ronda Rousey fight, especially in the second one, she made a lot of mistakes based on emotion and took the fight in places where she really shouldn't have. So when Ronda Rousey does return, I want to see, and these guys do probably fight, I want to see if she's still as cool, calm, and collected in that fight as she was in the one with Holm. And also,
You know, she is the champion, but Ronda Rousey is not in the division. So I think a part of Tate wants Ronda to return, and so they could have that fight so she could be the champion and say, look, I'm not just the champion because Ronda Rousey is taking a break. I'm the champion because I am the best. So I'm very interested to see what happens. And from the mental aspect, if she can stay that cool, calm, and collected and have a good game plan against Rousey, I think it would be a much different fight to their second one.
Yeah, and you talk about the mental aspect. Obviously, in the first couple of fights, both of them, even though she said she wouldn't do it in the second one, she did get emotional, Miesha Tate did. I saw a very, very nervous Miesha Tate walking into this fight. I know there wasn't much trash talk between her and Holly, but to me, she seemed extremely nervous, and I initially thought we may see a very emotional Miesha Tate, and we didn't. I do think we're seeing a more mature version than the one that fought Rousey, when was it? I think 2012, 2013? I think 2012. She's matured, and with that comes, I guess, the ability to stay calm and relaxed when needed. I would think that she would take it into their fight against Rousey. I know that it was obviously a personal one, but I also think you wouldn't have that lead up of the Ultimate Fighter, and things are still personal, but you got to wonder how aggressive Ronda would be with the trash talk going in against Miesha Tate. Let's not forget, Ronda was the champion. She had all the platform to be aggressive and talk trash. Now Misha's the champ. You got to wonder if Ronda Rousey will be a little bit more humble this time and sort of be a workman's Ronda Rousey trying to get back that belt. But in saying that, just quickly on this fight, for a large majority of the fight, Miesha found herself on the outside trying to get in on Holm without much success. So one would think in a rematch, it is entirely possible and plausible to visualize Holly Holm getting a win. Not saying that she would definitely, but it's something that is definitely within the realm of possibility. And considering that Holm was on her way to winning, I think she's still a threat for Miesha in the future. And, you know, if and when Rousey comes back, there's a very good chance that she'll beat Miesha as well. We're not sure what's happening with Kat Zingano, but she holds a win over Miesha. So to those sort of thinking about whether Miesha will be a long-term champion, I don't feel that way. And it's funny because Robbie Lawler is another guy who won the belt. And I think Johnny Hendricks, we were always talking about those guys not being long-term champions. Robbie Lawler, close fights. There were some that could have gone either way, but he's still a long-term champion, proving us wrong. With Miesha, I'm a little bit more confident to say I don't think she's necessarily going to hold the belt for very long. She may even lose it in her next fight, assuming it is Ronda Rousey like a lot of people think.
Yeah, she's definitely not a long-term champion. I do think, just quickly to the point that you brought, that Ronda Rousey will definitely bring a personal factor to this fight because Ronda Rousey understands that that's when she gets a weaker Miesha Tate, and she will, much like what she tried to do with Holly Holm in Melbourne at the weigh-in, try and use that to sort of shake her a little bit. But I'm still not sure that Miesha could handle it. I don't have the same mindset as you, Cass. I got to be honest, I'm not as sure she'll be able to be as cool, calm, and collected as against Holm. So I'm going to wait to see what happens in this build-up to really see what kind of thoughts I'm going to have on this matchup. But I do agree with you. I think Holm has a good chance of beating her if they have a rematch. Zingano obviously has a win over her. I'm not sure because, like you mentioned with Robbie, you know, we didn't think he was going to be a long-term champion, but here he is. He's still the champion. And in this game, it's so hard to predict what's going to happen. One of the things I am happy about, though, is the fact that it has sort of opened the gates to all these women like Zingano having another shot, having another chance at the title. And I mean, there's a few storylines they could play into with Tate being champion. Who knows how long Ronda Rousey is going to be around for it. And if Robin Black is right and she comes back for one fight and leaves, and it is this Miesha Tate fight, and Tate is somehow able to beat her in that fight, then it'll be great to see the fact that there'll be some other matchups in the wings for the UFC if that happens.
All right, well, we got your thoughts on, obviously, Miesha and where she's heading at. I didn't really hear too much from you about Holly Holm. What are your thoughts about Holly Holm's performance?
Well, you know, Robin Black and Mark all said that they believe that Holly did really well in this fight, and I think she did have a good strategy in the fight, but I actually wasn't very impressed with her performance. I think maybe it was because her last performance we saw destroy Ronda Rousey in dominating fashion. But when I was looking at Miesha Tate's striking and the gaps in her striking, more specifically her coming forward, her jab hand being down at her waist, I really thought Holm was going to do a lot more to take advantage of that. And I actually thought Tate did okay in some of the striking exchanges, which was actually able to hit Holm a few times. And the other area with Holm that I thought sort of really showed the gap in her skills was her grappling. I mean, with Ronda Rousey, I think we thought that her grappling has come along a lot further than it really has when she got out of that armbar situation, even took Ronda Rousey down herself. In this fight, when Tate got her down, I don't want to say she looked helpless, but to me, it sort of showed that she still has a long way to go in the grappling department, and made me think that if Ronda Rousey did have a rematch with her and was a lot more strategic and got her to the ground, she has a much higher chance of winning than I thought previously.
The reason why I'm impressed with Holly Holm, I mean, no doubt, there were massive, massive holes exposed in Holly Holm's ground game. And I think because we only saw little bits and pieces, like against Marion Renault, Marion pulled guard, was going for a triangle, and Holly popped out straight away. And then against Ronda Rousey, obviously Rousey went for the armbar, which is like, you know, the Mortal Kombat fatality, the finishing move. And, you know, she was able to avoid that and just got out of there straight away. We kind of thought, oh, wow, she must be amazing on the ground. But in a way, it was smoke and mirrors. We just never really saw much ground from Holly Holm. And here she was against Misha Tate, who's arguably one of the best grapplers in the division. She's just an absolute beast and has been getting better and better over the years. I mean, she out-grappled Sarah McMahon, which is a huge feat. So to see her being controlled by Misha Tate, it definitely showed a lot of holes. And it kind of makes you think that if Ronda Rousey did manage to get her on the ground and was a little bit more patient, maybe she'd be able to do a better job and potentially submit Holly Holm, or if there were more armbar opportunities and she was sort of focusing on position as opposed to sort of getting that submission straight away, you would see Ronda having a better chance. Mm. In saying that, I mean, Misha was... She did her homework and she timed Holly's left left straight, and that's what got her the takedown. And obviously in the second round, the fight almost ended for Holm. So I think for the rest of the fight, you saw a very reserved, slightly reluctant, very careful Holly Holm to not obviously get taken down in the same way. And she did. In the last round, that's exactly how she got taken down. She threw a left, it was a little bit of a sloppy left, and Misha capitalized it. It was like a kamikaze takedown, and she managed to get it. So I think in the first round, like, you saw Holly Holm hitting her with some decent shots. Second round, she got taken down, almost lost the fight. And I think from there on, she was like, all right, need to be a little bit more careful. And, you know, people talked about the matchup, the style that Misha Tate had. And we all know that a good wrestler can shut down a good striker. And I think in a small way, that happened. But nevertheless, there were still good shots that Holly landed. I mean, yes, she knocked out Ronda Rousey with an epic kick, and she's done that in the past. But, you know, a lot of her boxing fights, they were decisions. And she, especially in her hands, she doesn't really have that knockout power. There was a lot of sort of canceling each other out. There was a lot of times where Holly did go for head kicks. Misha blocked him. Misha would go for something. Holly Holm would dodge. And then Holly would get her with a side kick. So it was a sort of workmanlike performance. And then, of course, she got caught in the end, which made the fight so much more awesome.
I think it was the fact that Misha really got destroyed on the feet by a bunch of fighters who didn't have the striking credentials of Holm, which made me think Holm would just go in there and really dominate her. And even though Holm did land some really good shots, I think I expected more. I think the best way to put it is, after the Ronda Rousey fight, she looked superhuman. Like, who's going to beat this person? And I think after this fight, we realize, okay, she's a great fighter, but she's human and she's beatable. And I guess that's probably my takeaway from watching that fight and my thought on Holm and sort of her losing a little bit of that superhuman status in MMA.
I would definitely agree with that. I mean, she's no longer undefeated. Anytime that happens, that's a big deal. And coming off that win against Ronda, no doubt she was looking like superhuman. So the aura has been sort of cracked a bit. I'm curious to see how she comes back. I'm also really, really curious how Conor comes back and how this affects him. Like, I wonder if he'll... Well, I believe he'll rebound, but I wonder how he'll rebound. I mean, he found out that he can't KO everybody as quickly as he'd like, and with his few shots, it looks like that power doesn't necessarily translate too well to weight, and who knows if it even translates to lightweight. I mean, we'll talk about that in a moment, but will he be more economic in the future, and will we see his fights go a little bit longer than the first couple of rounds because he's trying to conserve energy and assure that he's got enough in the tank? Will he become... you know, potentially, I don't want to say a decision fighter, but as opposed to sort of going guns blazing in the first round, will he be going more into the second round, potentially even the third round, to make sure that he doesn't ever gas again like that? Will we see him applying a modified version of pressure where there isn't quite as much output? Will he have the same confidence when he returns to featherweight? Because he was on a massive run and a massive upswing on his way to winning the interim belt and the actual legitimate belt from Jose Aldo. Will he have that same confidence? Will he be able to rebound? And will he still be as eager to jump up different weight divisions at the drop of a hat in the future? That one I'm definitely doubtful of. I think he'll be a lot more careful. But either way, I'm very curious to see whether he makes those adjustments and what kind of version of him we see in the future.
No, yeah, I truly believe we'll probably see a better version of him in the future. I think with this fight, he believed his own hype a little bit too much. And he even admitted in the post-fight press conference that he didn't account for what Nate Diaz was going to do when he didn't go down with those knockout shots. I think usually when he does talk about knocking someone out in the first round or this round or that round, in the back of, his mind, he sort of does visualize what happens if that doesn't happen. And I think a big part of him really did believe he was going to go in there and knock Nate Diaz out in that first round. I think in the next fight, he'll still be really, really cocky, still build the fight the usual way that he does. But in the back of his mind, he'll visualize what's going to happen if I sort of don't finish Frankie Edgar in the first or second round. What's going to happen if it's in the fifth round? I think he'll account for those situations a bit more. And, you know, there's a lot of people that say, you know, Submission Radio hates Conor McGregor. We hate Conor McGregor. But it can't be further from the truth. You know, we're big Conor McGregor fans. I love watching him fight. I really loved the fact that he brought these big fight atmospheres to the card. It was, I haven't been excited for a card like this since when. I was very, very excited for it. And a part of me was pretty disappointed that he lost, because a lot of that aura for me is now gone from McGregor. So I'm very interested to see what's going to happen with him next, because we spoke about the fact a little bit earlier with Robin Black, you know, Chael Sonnen and Chuck Liddell, these guys lost. They came back. It was still exciting. But to me, a big part of McGregor's game was built on the fact that this guy, people believed, and you know, even I started to believe a little bit, that this guy could go to any weight class, you know, win any fight, you know, that he was sort of almost superhuman. And now that we see that he is human and he got beaten by Nate Diaz in that fight, to me, a lot of that aura sort of disappears. Do you know what I mean, Cass?
Oh, absolutely, 100%. A lot of people just wanted to jump on that roller coaster ride, whether you hated him or loved him. I don't think there was anyone who was really in between, but whether you're with him on that journey or not, you just wanted to see what was going to happen. You wanted to see if... One of the biggest parts of it was to see if you could back up that trash talk. He talked so much shit about all of his opponents, and you wanted to see whether, you know, he was going to get his comeuppance, for lack of a better term, or whether he really was that good. I mean, you know, talking about winning the welterweight belt, the lightweight belt, and I feel like people don't really expect him to win the welterweight belt anymore. People don't necessarily expect him to win the lightweight belt anymore. So I definitely agree that a lot of that mystique and aura is gone. I just have to say one thing, though. One of the things that I found interesting to watch was Conor's demeanor after the fight. He was sitting there at the press conference, obviously not with the outcome he expected. It was a massive bump in his road of obviously plans, and you could see him holding back tears. It was a very, very honest, vulnerable Conor McGregor, one without any bravado or any over-the-top remarks. Actually, there was a couple, and I saw the same look in Junior Dos Santos' eyes when he got beaten by Cain a few years ago. Very, very humbling experience for him. You could see him looking at Nate when he arrived with a look of respect that we previously didn't see. I don't know if you caught that, but when Nate came down and sat there, Conor was looking at him for, I don't know, like 30 seconds. I don't know what exactly he was thinking. I think he was still trying to process it, looking at him as if that's the guy that just beat me. That's the guy that took away a lot of the things that I was working for. I don't know. It looked like he was reaching out to him, just absolutely crushed. But despite all that, there was one question where he was asked whether it was Aldo or Edgar that deserved the title shot next. And I think it caught him off guard, because he may have been already thinking about, you know, RDA Lawler prior to this fight, you know, but being the constant promoter, he gritted his teeth. You could see he was holding back tears. He put on a brave face and he tried to sell both fights, as opposed to giving a generic, I'm not sure what's next, this just happened, answer. You know, he still tried to talk about Edgar and Aldo in a sort of, you know, salesmanship way. And I really respect that, because it would have been so much easier to just say, I don't know, I'm crushed at the moment, I have no answer for that.
Yeah, no, certainly. It was a very respectful in defeat, and I think won a lot of fans with that as well. I mean, incredibly hard to do, especially with all the talk leading into it. He's always very, very classy in losses or when he beats people as well. But I guess the big question is, how hard will it be for him to go back down to featherweight? Because it looked to me like he really enjoyed the fact he was able to eat what he wanted to eat, able to not worry about these weight cuts. And now he's going to be in a situation where he's not really going to be given a chance to go to lightweight, I don't believe. He'll have to go down to featherweight. And the big question is, you know, how many of those cuts can he take? Because We all know Conor McGregor is a super tough guy. But, you know, from John Kavanagh to Gunnar Nelson, guys have been on our show, guys that have been in the media, we know that is a massive, massive weight cut. We know that he's mentally strong, but humanly, how many of those weight cuts are possible? And also knowing the fact that he's got to go back down there now, because before there was an option where he could have just dropped the title at featherweight and worked his way into the other weight classes. Knowing now that he will have to fight maybe a couple more fights at featherweight, who knows what's going to happen, and make those weight cuts. I'm very interested to see how he's going to handle that and how long can his body take those weight cuts. What do you think about that whole situation, Case?
No, for sure. And I think there's a lot of added stress for him to have to go back to featherweight. I don't know how keen he was, because I know he said that he wanted to defend both belts, both the featherweight belt and the lightweight belt, but I feel like he would have enjoyed the lightweight, you know, belt and title defenses more. Maybe he wanted to go to welterweight so that he could still be a dual champion, but hold, you know, belts at weight classes where he didn't have to make that dreadful cut. And it always seemed like he had one foot out the door as far as featherweight went. It always seemed like, you know, from everything that he said, he wanted to win that belt, conquer that division, and then move on to bigger and better things. And I think in a way he was sort of relieved by that, thinking that, man, I'm not going to have to make this dreadful weight cut for too many more years. I mean, I think at this age, he's probably not growing anymore, but if he does keep training, if he does keep doing some of the exercises he's doing with Ido and all the lifts and the Olympic-style stuff, he is probably going to gain some more muscle, and that could eventually hinder him. If he's gaining more and more muscle and he's having to cut more and more water, drain himself even more, I mean, he's already insanely draining the weigh-ins. I think that's a big, I don't know, it's like you're playing a video game and you think you've conquered like a level, a boss or whatever, and then you die and you're like, man, I have to do all of that again. It's like Super Mario back in the day when like you didn't have save points, and once you die three times, you have to start all over again from scratch. So yeah. I think that's something that's going to weigh on him. What I'm curious about, though, is who's next for him? He's going back to featherweight. All signs point to that. Who do you think he should face? Should it be Edgar, Aldo? Is there anyone else we've forgotten about?
I really think Edgar should get the shot. I don't want to really see this Aldo rematch just yet. I feel like that's been done. Edgar's sort of a more fun and fresh matchup for UFC 200. But the big question is, and I mean, we spoke about this earlier, and I think we've brought this up in previous interviews, there is a real possibility he could lose against Frankie Edgar. And it's not like he's going down to fight a guy that he's sure he can beat. Frankie Edgar is a very, very, very tough opponent. And he's someone who's going to push McGregor very, very hard. So he's in this situation where if it is Edgar, not only does he have to worry about making the weight, but he's got to make sure that he's prepared for a guy like Edgar. And that's not an easy thing to do, especially by UFC 200. So to me, I think Edgar should get it, no doubt about it. Aldo, I think he should have another fight with someone else, sort of work his way back up to another title shot. I really don't think that rematch should happen at UFC 200. I don't know. Part of me just doesn't have much interest in that rematch at UFC 200. I want to see something fresh and new. I feel like that Edgar fight is fresh and new and more interesting to people, for people to watch. What about you, Cass?
Well, I'm still recovering from almost a year's worth of Aldo McGregor build-up. I mean, it feels almost like a trilogy. They've only had one fight, but I already feel like this is the third fight because there's been that many, you know, so much build-up. There's already been a world tour, a false start, and then we finally had the fight and it ended in 13 seconds. Listen, I think there's still some intrigue to that fight. If it happened tomorrow, I would definitely watch it. But I can't really go through months and months of build-up for UFC 200 only for it to be Aldo McGregor. It's like you're trying to do these huge things at UFC 200, and I don't think that Aldo McGregor is it. I think Edgar and McGregor is a big one. I think a lot of people, you're right, a lot of people believe that Edgar can beat him. There's a very good chance that he can. Edgar's deserved a title shot forever. I know that Aldo was obviously a champion for 10 years or so. I do think it's time for Edgar to finally get that deserved shot. The other thing is, I think Edgar and Conor would draw better because not only is it a fresh, heated rivalry, and it is heated. Edgar has a lot of stuff to say. He's certainly been more outspoken. And you saw from the Unstoppable press conference, everybody's trying to step up their game as far as trash talking. But also the fact that Edgar speaks English, so there's more chances for a war of words and better promotion. Given the fact that all the pay-per-view markets are English-speaking and places like Europe, Asia, and Brazil, they don't have to pay for pay-per-view, I think it may resonate stronger with fans from those countries, the English-speaking countries, the ones that do pay for pay-per-view, if Edgar and Conor can have a war of words. And again, I know that Aldo and Conor did really well the first time around, but I do feel like after the first fight being over in 13 seconds. Listen, I loved it. I think you loved it. I know that a lot of people wanted to see a war, though, and a lot of people were complaining that it was a very anticlimactic fight after such a huge build-up. I don't know how they can build it up bigger, and I think a lot of people would be very hesitant to give it another go. And it's just not something that you want to do on a big pay-per-view like UFC 200, where you're hoping to do big numbers and break records.
Yeah, certainly. I feel like Aldo just needs to go out there, sort of have another fight, and remind everybody why he was the pound-for-pound best fighter in the world, and then sort of get everybody excited about the possibility of him fighting McGregor. But, you know, it's one of those situations as well where that was going to be, no doubt about it, McGregor versus Edgar, the headlining fight for UFC 200. I mean, it'll still probably be the headlining fight, but now that McGregor's lost, I don't know, it loses a lot of that momentum. I mean, that fight could have carried the card in a lot of ways. And now I think it's up to the UFC to really put a lot more marquee matchups on the card if they want it to be the biggest card of all time. But before we go, Cass, I just want to quickly touch on Nate Diaz and this big win that Nate Diaz has had over Conor McGregor. Now, a lot of people see this as the end of McGregor's run in welterweight for the foreseeable future. But a good point that's been brought up on the internet a number of times is the fact that Nate Diaz is a 155er. He's a lightweight. He's not a welterweight. And even though both men were at 170, Diaz's optimum weight is 155, which brings up the question of, if McGregor does go up to light heavyweight, would he be able to hang?
Light heavyweight. With
the guy? I mean, light heavyweight, lightweight. Imagine that, go straight up to light heavyweight and fight John Jones. Now, if he goes up to lightweight, can he hang with the guys in lightweight? And is him losing to Nate Diaz just a sign of what would come if he did move to lightweight?
Look, I mean, the UFC marketing machine, they can spin it a lot of ways. There's always the excuses of he went up two weight class, which is, wasn't really two weight classes. It was one weight class, and then they both guys fought without cuts. There's the fact that it was a short notice fight. And that's one. That's another thing that I just want to quickly kill, that excuse. Because I know a lot of people will say, oh, McGregor took a fight on short notice. It was a different opponent. He was preparing for RDA. Well, McGregor has said multiple times that he doesn't train for any specific opponent. He trains in general. And that's a big belief in not only McGregor, but SBG in general. They don't really have much of a focus on specific opponents. They train and obviously look to get better in all aspects as opposed to, you know, certain styles and certain strengths. So I don't believe in that notion. But yeah, man, this is, it's not the same Nate Diaz who got beaten by RDA. This is a much better version. But nevertheless, he got beaten by a guy who is on a good run, but has been on good runs in the past and has never been a champion and got beaten soundly by the champion. And of course, I'm talking about Nate Diaz. So being beaten by a legitimate 155-pounder without the weight cut, I don't think it bodes well for Conor McGregor at 155. Not yet. I mean, he says that with a few minor adjustments, he could potentially beat Nate Diaz. I'd be interested in seeing a fight later down the road, potentially a rematch between these two. I have no idea how they could possibly top this build-up, and I don't think they could. I don't think it's the end of Conor McGregor at lightweight, but he's definitely going to have to go back to the drawing board and improve on a lot of things. I mean, we saw RDA. We always mention this. I mean, he's a perfect example of a massive comeback story, beaten by Clay Guida, getting knocked out in the past, and now I believe by Jeremy Stephens, and now he's the champion, and people saying he's potentially, you know, he's on a crazy run, and I don't know, the only guy that people are saying could beat him potentially is Khabib Nurmagomedov. So Conor McGregor could fall into that category, but he's going to have to reinvent himself to a degree and at least fight more economically, and I think he's gotten that wake-up call that if he does come to lightweight, he may not be knocking guys out like he's doing at featherweight. In fact, there's a very good chance he won't be.
Yeah, absolutely. And if you just look through the lightweight division, guys like Donald Cerrone, Edson Barboza, Michael Johnson, Tony Ferguson, and Anthony Pettis, all these guys are pretty
Khabib.
Long. And they also, the deal with them is like they've taken some power shots before. So it's not, like you mentioned, it's going to be a situation where it's going to be a completely different game plan for McGregor if he does move to lightweight than if he's in featherweight. Where in featherweight, he's looking to knock these guys out. In lightweight, he's got to come up with a different strategy because he just won't be able to. These guys are used, because of the weight difference, and there is a weight difference and size difference, these guys are used to getting hit by much bigger men, much harder shots, much like Nate Diaz was sparring with those boxers. So it will be interesting to see what happens in the future if he does move to lightweight. But I think one of the saddest things that McGregor had to deal with in that press conference is the fact that he doesn't really have a choice what he's going to do now
It's more in the UFC's hands, and I think the UFC are going to make him stay in featherweight for the foreseeable future until something happens. At least the next couple of fights, I expect to see McGregor a featherweight, unless he can't make the weight anymore. And then we'll see an interesting situation where he enters lightweight, but depending on what happens to him at featherweight, he may enter it fighting guys near the bottom of the top 10 ranking and not getting an immediate title shot. It'll be interesting to see what happens.
Well, it might be tough if he loses to Frankie Edgar and then he has to go to lightweight.
Imagine
and
that.
He's not even
Imagine
a champion
that.
There. Yeah.
That would be crazy. But I mean, that's a big possibility. If he, like I said, there's a real possibility that this year McGregor suffers two losses in a year. Because even if he fought RDA, that was an incredibly tough fight as well. And Frankie Edgar is a very, very tough opponent too. So again, I really want to see McGregor win because I think it does great things for MMA, but there's a real possibility he may be entering lightweight, not fighting for the title, but just fighting for the ability, I mean, to make himself relevant in the division. So very
and
interesting stuff.
The thing that Nate Diaz and Frankie Edgar share is obviously their fantastic cardio. And we saw Conor Gass in this fight. So I'm not writing Conor off against Frankie Edgar. I'm definitely not doing that. But you're right. It is a very real possibility that Frankie Edgar becomes the champion. And then we see a rematch between Frankie Edgar and Aldo, which would be crazy. And that's the other reason why this Edgar fight makes sense. Because either way, Aldo, I feel like he will get a rematch for the title. Even if he sits out and doesn't take a fight in the interim, he will get that, you know, at some point. And just quickly, before we pull the plug on the show, we obviously got to mention Nate Diaz. What do you think is next for Nate Diaz? I mentioned Robbie Lawler. I think that fight makes sense. I know Mark Romandi did a pretty good job convincing me that RDA may make sense. You can definitely market it that way. I mean, he is an improved version. I just think that Nate Diaz versus Robbie Lawler, it's the bigger fight. If you're going to do that UFC 200, it is the bigger fight. And wouldn't that be crazy, though? I mean, who do you give the main event to? Is it if Conor McGregor is fighting Frankie Edgar and Nate Diaz is hypothetically fighting Robbie Lawler, this is assuming that GSP doesn't pan out, which who knows, it may not. Who do you give the main event to? Is it Nate Diaz or is it Conor McGregor, even though Nate beat him?
Well, here's an interesting perspective for you, Casper. If Ronda Rousey, she's not coming back for July, but if Ronda Rousey did come back in July and fought Miesha Tate, I strongly believe 80% of me would be sure that she would actually headline over McGregor and at Edgar. Whereas before that would have never happened. Before, if Conor would have won this fight, no doubt about it, he would have been the headliner no matter what the fight's going to be. So yeah, with this Nate Diaz Robbie Lawler fight, and I agree with you because I really think that Nate's in this position where he's past what division he's in. He's in the position where you got to give this guy a big fight. And you don't want to waste him on an opponent like, for example, for me, I feel like it's a waste if he fights like an Eddie Alvarez or something like that. Because I think there's a strong possibility that Eddie might be able to beat him. And then all that hype goes out the window. I think you really want to capitalize on this with a big, big fight. So I agree with you. I think Robbie Lawler is the way to do it. I don't want to see this RDA rematch. It's just too recent for me, and I really believe that it's too recent in most people's minds. I think that's the way to do it. And if they're on the card with McGregor and Edgar, I still think McGregor and Edgar would be the main event just because the trash talk would be a lot better between them because Robbie doesn't really say much, and I think there'll be an element of respect between Nate Diaz and Robbie in this fight. I don't think Nate Diaz is going to talk too much shit to Robbie, even though there is a history there. Maybe sort of there'll be a bit of pushing and shoving in the stare downs and stuff like that, but Robbie won't really engage in a war of words. And just because of that, I do believe the build-up will be bigger between McGregor and Edgar and push them to the main event, but it'll be a very, very close decision.
And I think that's the other sort of lesson here. Make those big fights while you can.
I
mean, you could make Nate Diaz, Eddie Alvarez, and it's not so much about, you know, caring who wins, but if Nate does lose, then that Robbie Lawler fight's out the window. Whereas now, it's still here on the table.
And I just don't think it would make Eddie Alvarez a much bigger star. Because I think if the title's not involved, if this isn't the be-all and end-all main event, I feel like there's not as much importance in it. And even though if he does beat Nate Diaz, then in a lot of ways, I don't know, it even takes more away from Conor McGregor. Because then if he ever moves up to lightweight, you're like, well, Eddie Alvarez smashed through Nate Diaz who beat McGregor. You know, all this stuff starts coming into play, all this MMA math. So it's definitely not a fight that I want to see next for Nate Diaz. I want to see him in a fight where it's going to be exciting. And Robbie's going to stand there and bang with Nate, and it's going to be a very exciting fight no matter what happens.
Look, I do think Nate Diaz has a good chance to beat Eddie Alvarez, especially in a five-round fight. And I do think it would make Eddie Alvarez a bigger star, for sure. He would definitely capitalize on Nate Diaz's momentum, but I think it also depends on how he beats him. If he has a similar fight to the way he beat Pettis, which was a huge win for him, taking on a guy that was recently a champion, but just not the most exciting fight, that may hurt him. If he decisions Nate Diaz like that, say in a 3-round fight or a 5-round fight, I mean, it could potentially hurt Eddie Alvarez and obviously his chances of getting a lightweight title shot.
Yeah, but I mean, he can't make it. Just can't. He can't get that popular offered because he can't be a main event for a big card, and that means he's either got to be a main event or of a fight night or a co-main event of a big card. And I just feel like if you're not a main event of a card, if all the attention isn't on you, if you're not selling the event, you're just not going to get as popular from the aftermath from it. You might get some popularity from it, but because there's no title involved and there'll be a title shot over them and a pay-per-view if that's where they are, or if it's a fight night, a card that people aren't really focusing on that much, a lot of that rub's going to be taken away.
Sure. No, I don't know, of course. I mean, I wasn't saying if they give him Alvarez now. I'm saying, like, in the future, if they give it to
if
him.
If he's champion and Alvarez beats him and he's the champ,
not even that. I mean, like, let's say, I guess if Nate Diaz does beat Robbie Lawler, then yeah, of course Eddie Alvarez is going to become a star. But I guess you're right though. If you give him Robbie Lawler,
I just don't think it's going to do much for Eddie. More people will be like, oh yeah, Eddie beat him. But I just think it just in a lot of ways it just shits on everything. Shits on what Nate Diaz did. Shits on Conor McGregor if he goes into the division. Shits on everything, yeah.
Just shit everywhere. Just a whole bunch of shit. It's just a big shit fest. Anyway, I think on that note, we're gonna wrap up, finish the show. Obviously, thank you so much for listening. Thank you to our guests, Mark Raimondi and Robin Black, and of course, the always hilarious Tommy Toehold. We hope you guys enjoyed the show. Give us your feedback in the YouTube comments below. You can always hit us up on Twitter at SubmissionAUS. Follow us on Facebook. facebook.com/submissionradioAUS. Also, big thank you to all the awesome reviews we've been getting recently. Just a whole bunch of 5-star reviews coming in there. If you do have the time, take a second and want to support the show, feel free to give us a review. No pressure. Give us whatever rating you think we deserve and what you think we've earned. And I think that's pretty much it. And Dennis.
Yeah, and a happy 4-year anniversary, Tommy Toehold, for doing his amazing show for 4 years.
Mm.
It's tough for people that don't realize, it's tough to sort of be in the MMA space because it isn't as developed as a lot of the major sports like NFL and NBA. And to have Tommy do these high quality shows for such a long time, I mean, it's just a testament to the fact of how awesome he is and how dedicated he is to entertain the fans. So happy 4-year anniversary, Tommy. And it's great to have him on the show around that time.
Absolutely, guys. We'll be back next week for one more episode, and then obviously we're heading into UFC Brisbane. So exciting times. Stay safe till then. We'll catch you next week.